Hello, my name is Dom, and today I'll be showing you how to scrape and parse information using beautiful soup. So today we'll be scraping a website of Pokemon. What we have is a website that's built specifically for scraping, so it's going to make our life a bit easier. We have a whole bunch of Pokemon, Bulbasaur, Ivysaur. Every single one has a price, and every single one also has a description, some stock number, and some other information. So we'll see how to extract all of this information out of the website. Okay, so first things first, what we need to do is install a library called Beautiful Soup. We do that with pip. If you have it already, then you may see a message like this. If you haven't installed it, and then you'll see pip installing it. Along with Beautiful Soup, we'll pick up a library called Requests that's going to help us make network requests. Yeah, so I already have both of these packages. Pip will say that I have them. Your output will be slightly different. Okay, so first things first, what we need to do is we actually need to call the URL to fetch the HTML into our scraper, and then we'll load Beautiful Soup and we'll try and parse it. In order to pick up our Pokemon information from the web, we need to copy the URL and scrape the HTML into our Python script using requests. So we'll do that now. Now, I like printing my responses every single time I do something just to make sure what I'm doing makes sense. So that's easy enough. We see a 200. If we actually output the content, we see the HTML for the whole website. Now, clearly, this is not easy to use, so let's start parsing it. Next, let's load everything into Beautiful Soup. Now, Beautiful Soup has a couple of parsers. Here, we'll just use a default HTML parser. Let's see how this looks like. Forgot to import it. Okay, so we're starting to see some structure over here. So let's look at one Pokemon first, and then we'll see how to extract all of them. If you right-click on Chrome, you probably know about Chrome Development Tools. They allow you to quickly see elements inside of a website. And for today, it is going to be helpful for us to see what sort of classes we can use to pick up elements. So looking at Bulbasaur over here, I can see that we have a href that actually links to the actual Bulbasaur listing. We have an image, we have a price, and of course we have the title itself. So if you've seen this little tool over here, we can use it to point to specific elements, and we can see the class for that title. So we're going to pick up this class, and what we're going to do now is we will try to find the HTML element that has that class in order to pick up the content. So the find method is a field in the soup class. It accepts an HTML element, an H2 in this case, and the class underscore field allows us to select that class. And here, we just copied it the way that we found it. If we run this, we see Bulbasaur. If we wish to extract just the text, what we can do is we can add the text property over here. And that should give us Bulbasaur. So likewise, let's pick up the price. We can see that it's a span. It has a class of price. And lastly, each Pokemon also has a URL to their specific listing, so we'll pick up the URL. Now here, the actual property is not text within the A element, it's actually the href attribute. So we'll pick it up same way as we access a dictionary. Okay, looking good. Now, scraping one Pokemon is easy. Let's see what do we need to do in order to scrape all of these Pokemon on this page. So first things first, we have a quick look at the structure of the site. We see that each Pokemon is an li or a list element, and all of them belong to UL or unordered list. So what we'll need to do is we'll need to select the unordered list and then go through each child of the list to pick up each li associated with each Pokemon. This is going to pick up all of the UL elements. and this should pick up all the LIs. Note that when we want to find one element, we use find, and we wish to find all elements, we go for find all. Let's see how this looks like. Okay, so we see a list of A's or anchor links and all the other Pokemon stuff. In order to make this output a bit more workable, let's pick up the stuff that we need. So let's do what we did previously. Let's just pick up every single element and all the information we need. Now, the cool thing with Beautiful Soup is you can actually just pick up an element that you selected with Beautiful Soup before and continue selecting from it. Okay, so we see a nice little list over here. I left the print over here that we don't need. Next thing, we'll need to actually save all these Pokemon to an array. I do not know plural for Pokemon, so I'll use Pokemons. And a quick tip, if you want to pretty print a object like this, what you can use is you can use pprint. You need to import it from pprint, import pprint. Okay, so this is much more readable. We got the price, we got the title, and we got the URL. I'm gonna get rid of some of this used code. So in order to make life easier for the next steps, I'm actually going to turn some of this stuff here into functions. So nothing new here. We just move the request call to this function and we create the Beautiful Soup object. And then in Pokemon lists, we create the UL object and we return all of the LI elements. We call the functions. It should work the same. Okay. And then inside of here, we also parse each individual Pokemon, so we can make a function out of this as well. Now I'm picking up these snippets because I've written them beforehand, but you can see that the stuff here is exactly the same. Can get rid of all of this stuff over here. And now that I look at it, I guess we're not really scraping the Pokemon, but parsing the Pokemon because we already have the data. So let's call this parse Pokemon. So same deal, name, price, URL. We create a Pokemon object with those fields and then we return it. And when we look at the body of our code, it looks much more compact. Okay, so we scraped one page, but if we go back to the website, we can see that we have many pages. And if we need to pick up the information from multiple pages, we'll have to do some additional steps. Now here, I'm gonna start with 5 pages. I'm gonna make a quick little loop and we'll create the URL using this string formatting. There's a couple of ways to format strings in Python. I personally just like this percentage sign. So let's do the same that we're doing here. Soup, li elements. If I can actually quickly print these elements to make sure that this stuff makes sense. Now you can already see a delay in between the runs. So it's already taking some time for the script to run. I'm gonna change this page number to just 3, just to make it a bit faster. And let's parse every single one of these Pokemon. And I'm going to comment out this stuff for now. All that we need is the Pokemon array or list and the number of pages. Let's see how this works. Also, just to see the script going for pages, I'm gonna add a print here. So we can see which page we're triggering. Okay, so we see we got Pokemon from 3 pages, which is much more. If we wanted to, we can put this number to 30 or 40. I'm not gonna go above 3, just to save some time on this. Just to quickly recap, we have a list for Pokemons. We have a number of pages. We loop through each page, which is just an integer. We construct a URL with the pages number at the end. And we do the same stuff as before. Create a soup element, extract all the LI elements, and then parse each Pokemon. Next up, if we go to the listing of each Pokemon, we'll see if there's any interesting data we can pick up from it. So opening up Bulbasaur, we see a price, we see the stock number, we have an image if you want to pick that up, and some other information. So for this, I'll pick up something that I cannot get from the main search page. I'll pick up the description and I'll pick up the stock number. So what we need to do now is we need to look for the actual Pokemon. So let's just stick to one page for now. Let's make sure we actually have the URLs for our Pokemon. Well, we only need to call that. And now let's scrape the individual Pokemon page. Now here we'll have to come back to developer tools to find the correct classes. Let's hover over this description. Okay, so seems to be a div with a P. Okay, now since we're opening every single page, we're gonna print each Pokemon separately, but we can see we can pick up the description. Also interesting note, even though our div has a P element, we can still look for text and we don't need to worry about the nested ancestor being P or something else. And let's also do the same for stock. So let's have a look over here. Okay, and let's add these properties to our Pokemon. And a quick little fix, since we also want to actually change the underlying Pokemon to have these fields, instead of iterating through them, we'll have to iterate for their indices and then mutate each Pokemon. Let's get rid of these prints. And again, if we try to get through every single Pokemon, it's going to take forever. So instead of this, I'm just going to go through 5 Pokemon. Okay, so if we look at the top result over here, we can see a description with the empty line character at the start, name, price, stock, and URL. I'm not going to clean up the strings right now, but you know, you can do your splitting and parsing fairly easily. Okay, so quick recap. We have one page. We pick up the first 5 Pokemon here. We scrape the Pokemon page. We find the description and the stock, and we add those back to the Pokemon list. And this is looking pretty good. You could already pull this in and use it in some of your projects if you wanted to. Of course, this is a dummy page that makes scraping fairly easy. So let's look at the more real-world example. So let's try and apply what we've learned by scraping Amazon.com. So what I have here is a listing for Razorblade laptops. We're going to make a request just like we did before. And straight off the bat, you can see that we're actually hitting a 503 if we try to call the URL through our script. If we have a look at the content, you can actually see to discuss automatic access, blah, blah, blah. So clearly Amazon is blocking us because it's detecting that we are trying to interact through their web page with a script. Now, one way of improving your chances on avoiding bot detection is to imitate the same exact request that the way that the browser is doing it. So in order to do it here, what I'm going to do is I'm going to go to network on DevTools. I'm going to restart or refresh the page, and I'm going to go to the very, very first request. If you right click on this request and select copy, you can actually copy this request with all the setup and all the headers that Chrome uses. There's no Python requests format here, but there's curl. If we paste that curl request, you can see a whole bunch of information here. If we try sending it, you can see we still hear an error saying, sorry, something went wrong on our end. Please go back and try again. In order to get away from these restrictions, one option that we have is to use residential proxies. So let's hop over to smartproxy.com. Now I have a residential subscription right over here. I have a username and password, and also a list of endpoints that I can use. So let's set up requests to use proxies. So we have a proxies dictionary. Right here, we're making an HTTP request. So we have a field for that. Here we input our smartproxy username and password. Don't worry about it. This password will be rotated by the end of this video. And I'm also pinging the US domain because I want my results to show up for the US market. Let's try running our request now. So we see we're still hitting the same automation detection. Let's bring in the headers that we use on Chrome. Now I have a handy copy over here. And let's pass these two requests. Okay, so we have our HTML blob from Amazon. Now in this particular case, I don't actually need the cookies and I don't need the referrer. Okay, and here we already know what to do. We hop over into developer tools. We try and find the relevant information and we parse it. Let's find the list of items. That's the main container. Well, let's actually create the beautiful soup object. And this guy over here should be HTML parser. Okay, we got our product blob. Now here I'm looking for the child that has both the price and the title. This all looks good. And that's a div. So, okay, I renamed this part to products div. We find the individual products, which are also divs, and then we print every single one of them. And let's find this price. Also, quick note, you probably know that some listings on Amazon don't actually have a price, like this one over here. So we want to account for that. So you can see already, scraping by hand can be a very fragile process. I'm able to extract the price fairly easily. However, I can't actually figure out why that title is not being picked up by this class. It could be that since we're using residential proxies, the actual HTML that the script sees is different. There's also no guarantee that this price selector is going to stay in place as well, but we have a better solution. So if you wish to scrape a popular e-commerce website like Amazon.com, you can actually use Smartproxy to do all of the hard work for you. Let's hop into the dashboard and let's open up the scraping products over here. Here we have a number of offerings. I'm going to use e-commerce today. And right over here, we have an Amazon search target that we can use. I'm going to paste in the same query as we had before. And I'll hit start scraping. And as you can see over here, I have the same information with the price, title, and some additional stuff all done for me. Now, if I wish to use all of the stuff over here in my source code, I can easily hop into requests and I can select Python over here and I can copy this whole request. Let's make a new file. Let's paste it in. And let's run it. And we can pretty print the response over here as well. So as you can see over here, along with the title, the price is somewhere over here. There it is. We get a whole bunch of other information that can be useful for our project. And that is way easier than scraping or parsing by yourself. And that is it. So today we used Beautiful Soup to parse information that we scraped from the web. We used residential proxies to get away from websites blocking us. And we also used Scraper API, which did all of the hard work for us. We'll see you all in the next video.